In East Africa, Al-Shabaab's recent attack on Kenya's Westgate shopping mall in Nairobi is being seen by security experts as evidence that the Al-Qaeda-affiliated group remains a formidable and possibly growing threat in the region. Al-Shabaab controls large parts of southern Somalia and imposes an extreme version of Sharia law, including stoning women accused of adultery and amputating hands to punish theft. While Al-Shabaab has lost control of territory, it has maintained its operational capability. Somali Defense Minister Abdul Hakim Haj Faki says it will take more than its forces to stop Al-Shabaab.
The issue of Al-Shabaab is not a Somali issue only today, as you know. After the Westgate Mall attack, this is a wake-up call for the international community, for the countries in the East African region, to help Somali security sectors and Somali government to defeat Al-Shabaab.
Well, the U.S. reaction to the Westgate Mall attack has been cautious. The U.S. military, which has a small presence in Kenya, is reviewing its tactics and the work its teams are doing to train Kenyan forces. More on that from VOA Pentagon correspondent Luis Ramirez.
The attack on Nairobi's Westgate Mall is seen as retaliation for strikes by Kenyan forces on Al-Shabaab targets in Somalia. Now, the U.S. is weighing how to respond and possibly boost assistance to the Kenyan army. Defense analyst Seth Jones, testifying before a U.S. congressional panel, told lawmakers the approach should not end up helping Al-Shabaab recruit more fighters.
I think one thing that we've got to be careful about is we don't encourage the Kenyans to overreact, conduct overt attacks within Somalia.
Observers say images of Kenyans attacking Somalis with U.S. assistance would help Al-Shabaab gain sympathy, especially among young Somalis. The U.S. has announced no plans to boost its presence in Kenya beyond the 150 U.S. troops who are now there, helping Kenyan forces build their capacity. Al-Shabaab has lost much of its territory in Somalia, but analyst Catherine Zimmerman says the Nairobi attack shows the U.S. and its partners have much more work to do.
The strategy is working in parts, but it's not going to work long term. It's been able to hold off the rise of Al-Shabaab enough to keep it from growing throughout East Africa, but what we've seen is a resurgence there.
The Kenyans' response to the mall attack showed deficiencies in professionalism and command and control capabilities. Reports say some first responders to the mall attack were seen looting rather than rescuing victims, and there are complaints of disorganized rescue efforts and heavy-handed tactics that resulted in victims' deaths. Analyst Vanda Felba-Brown says those types of tactical and technical issues should be easy for U.S. trainers to fix.
In some ways, figuring how you knock down the door is far easier than figuring how you get broad intelligence. And the fact that the Kenyans struggled even with this tactical bit so much shows the real paucity of capacities despite our training so far.
For now, U.S. officials consider Al-Shabaab a regional threat with no real capacity to hit U.S. territory. However, memories of the 1998 U.S. embassy attacks in East Africa by Al-Qaeda, then also considered only a regional threat, are bolstering calls for closer attention and a strong, albeit low-key, U.S. response. Luis Ramirez, VOA News, at the Pentagon.
Well, for more perspective on the security situation in Somalia, we are joined by Mr. Abdi Ainte, Director, Heritage Institute for Policy Studies, Mogadishu, Somalia. Mr. Ainte, welcome to Africa 54.
Thank you.
Now, first, you are in Mogadishu itself. Tell us, how does it feel like being in Mogadishu, a city that has been under the control of Al-Shabaab for quite some time?
Well, Al-Shabaab in Mogadishu does not have a formal presence, but its presence is also felt as an invisible force.
Yeah.
They remain a constant and a poignant, really, threat to peace and security in Mogadishu, despite the fact that they have been dislodged from the city about 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Now, some say that moving south perhaps is a tactical move, but from your perspective, from what you know, is Al-Shabaab a weakened force?
Well, it depends on how you read it. Speaking conventionally, Al-Shabaab has certainly been defeated as a conventional force from many parts of Somalia, including Mogadishu and Kismayo, and a lot of major cities across the country. But I think they, first of all, still continue to hold on to large swathes of land in south-central Somalia. And secondly, I think the paradox is that they seem to be sometimes stronger as an unconventional force engaged in an urban warfare with small cells operating in urban cities like Mogadishu and other places.
Mm-hmm. Now, initially it was seen like they were fighting for some cause for Somalia, but given that they have become affiliated with Al-Qaeda, there's an infusion of the Al-Qaeda ideology. Is this making their view of things different, perhaps even their objectives a little different than before?
Well, I think even initially, a few years ago, when Al-Shabaab first burst into the scene, they've utilized the nationalist rhetoric quite smartly, and primarily to harness the anger and the support of the Somali people, who were at the time, you know, insensitive about the Ethiopian intervention in Somalia in 2007 and 2008. But even then, I think it was pretty clear to a lot of people that Al-Shabaab were not particularly a nationalist movement as much as it is a transnationalist movement interested more in global jihad than in protecting Somalis. If Al-Shabaab was seriously interested in protecting the Somali people, it would not have certainly bombed the Somali people in Mogadishu and in other places and killed many of them on the justification that they do not subscribe to their own brand of Islam.
Yes. Now, there are all these calls about the international community helping. From what you know, how best can the international community get involved? How can it help to eliminate this threat?
Well, this is where it gets a bit more complex. I think the international community has a role, and I think their role principally should be in the rebuilding of a competent, professional Somali National Army, which will probably be the only institution that has the capacity to ultimately defeat the Shabaab. What has been happening, over the past few years is an attempt to increase the capacity of the African Union peacekeeping mission, which has done a remarkable job of actually defeating the Shabaab from many parts of Somalia. However, that's not the ultimate answer to the Shabaab. I think that's a stopgap measure. But along with that needs to be the establishment of an inclusive and professional Somali army. It's a very difficult and long job. Just to give you a quick example on this, there are only 18,000 troops for Somali National Army at the moment. You need several hundred thousand to effectively defeat Al-Shabaab.
That's a very monumental task, but really critical. Yeah, it has to be a homegrown solution. Thank you very much, Mr. Ainte. Abdi Ainte is the director, Heritage Institute for Policy Studies in Mogadishu, Somalia.